Sorry, are you missing a D there?
Thanks, though. Okay, so I'll be talking about the program, The Quantum Wave in Computing, which is in spring 2020. And it's organized by Andrew Childs, Ignacio Serac, Umesh Vazirani, and Tomas Vidic. Now, in upcoming years, we expect to have quantum devices with upwards of 50 noisy qubits. So these practical developments bring with them major theoretical challenges, and the program will focus on these challenges. So these challenges can be roughly split into two categories. The first is algorithmic. So in this setting, the question is, what can we do with these limited near-term quantum devices? So what useful computations are possible with these devices? In the longer term, once we reach our eventual goal of full-scale, fault-tolerant quantum computing, the question is, what are the applications of these computers? So we expect that the key application should be simulation of physical systems, but there are many other applications which we will explore in the program. Now, the other major theoretical challenge has to do with testing these computers. So once we have larger quantum computers, we will no longer be able to classically simulate these devices with supercomputers due to the exponential complexity of quantum states. Currently, we're still underneath this threshold. So in practice, people are using techniques such as benchmarking or testing for quantumness via supremacy. But eventually, we will have to deal with this issue of testing larger quantum computers. So in this talk, I'm just going to focus on this issue of testing, since at its core, this issue of testing is a complexity theoretic question with deep ties to classical cryptography. Now, if I want to phrase it as a complexity theoretic question, here's how to see it. Our goal is to classically verify some quantum behavior. So we have a classical computer, which we refer to as a verifier, and a quantum computer, which we refer to as a prover. And the verifier is going to interact with the prover, and the goal of this interaction is to verify some quantum behavior. So there are many things we could hope to verify. For example, we could want to verify that the machine is quantum. So we could want to achieve quantum supremacy. Or we could want to verify the output of a general quantum computation, or something like homomorphic encryption, or certified randomness generation. But all of these questions are just about the power of interactive proofs. So how much power can this weak classical verifier have over a quantum prover? Now, this imbalance between the verifier and the prover can be addressed by classical cryptography. And here's how. So the quantum prover is quite powerful, but he's not all powerful. We can take advantage of the fact that the quantum machine is still efficient. So he's polynomial time bounded, and we can assume that there are certain problems that even an efficient quantum computer cannot solve. In other words, I'm assuming quantum secure cryptography, which is classical cryptography that an efficient quantum computer cannot break. Now, so far what I've said is that the verifier is much weaker than the prover, and in order to level the playing field, all I've done is I've upper bounded the power of the quantum prover. But the verifier still remains much weaker than the prover. So in order to handle this, we can give the verifier access to a trapdoor. And for example, with the one-way function, access to the trapdoor would allow the verifier to invert the one-way function, while the quantum prover still could not invert the function. So in this way, by giving the verifier access to something that the quantum prover does not have, we can level the playing field between a classical verifier and a quantum prover. And this structure of using cryptography to allow the classical verifier power over a quantum prover has been used in a recent line of works to achieve various cryptographic tasks, including classical verification of quantum computation, homomorphic encryption, certified randomness generation, and quantum supremacy. All of these results rely on the assumption that the learning with errors problem is quantum secure. So these results introduce an exciting new connection between classical cryptography and quantum computing, more specifically between lattice problems and quantum computing. And it seems like this connection would be best explored by collaboration between those who work on lattices and those in quantum computing. And that's why spring 2020 seems like an ideal time to explore these questions given the concurrent lattice program. And as example of, let me just give you a few examples of the types of questions we can explore. Now, in all of the current results, we heavily relied on the structure of learning with errors to build these protocols. And it was quite surprising that learning with errors did have enough structure to allow that problem to be so useful with quantum computers. And one question is whether there are other structural properties of lattice problems which we haven't explored yet, which could be useful in other types of quantum cryptographic tasks. And another question has to do with standardization of lattice problems. So we expect that in upcoming years, RSA will eventually be phased out to be replaced by lattice problems. And as part of that standardization process, we need to figure out what structural properties of lattice problems make them both efficient and keep them secure against quantum computers. And that type of question seems like it would really best be handled by people working on quantum algorithms and lattices, so we can figure out more about the structure of these problems. And I'll end there.
Questions?
What are the reasons behind the belief that the structural learning with errors is quantum secure?
What are the reasons behind the belief that the structure of learning with errors is quantum secure?
It's quantum secure.
The structure of learning with errors.
What makes these problems hard for quantum computers?
Basically, there's been a lot of effort put into breaking these problems, and we haven't been able to. So we have quantum algorithms which work with certain types of structure, like with factoring. And this type of structure is not present in learning with errors because we have noise. And that's why we can't get our current quantum algorithms to work.
Maybe the other thing you can think about is that lattice problems are very closely related to the dihedral of hidden subgroup problem. So the successes in quantum algorithms like factoring, discrete log, etc., these are abelian hidden subgroup problems. But once you get to sufficiently non-abelian groups, then the problems seem to be quite hard, and these are very, very closely related in the sense that you can reduce back and forth, and in fact that's where the LWE crypto system came.
Is there any work on sort of verifying the operation of a complex quantum computer with a simpler quantum computer? Like, for example, the fact that verification with a classical machine is obviously great when you, and that's a nice result, by the way. I guess my question, if we had modest power quantum machines, Would it change the problem, like in terms of the complexity assumptions we need?
There was a lot of work on that before this because we didn't know how to handle it with a classical verifier. And there what was shown that if the verifier has the capability of just receiving a single qubit and performing measurements, it's enough to verify information theoretically without computational assumptions.
It's much harder to test with classical.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the question is, yes, it's possible without any computational assumptions. There are some issues with fault tolerance, so it's not clear whether it would be practically useful, but that's another line of research.
All right, thanks again.